reminded me that the schedule had called for a 1:40 return time. So we're going to split the difference. So hopefully folks are back now and ready to go. We may end up a little early, which would be fine. And don't want to delay access to this great information any longer. Our next speaker from Clemson University, Michael Caterino. Diversity in the duff. What does DNA metabarcoding reveal about leaf litter arthropods in the Smokies?
Hello, let me get shared here. All right. Are we good? I'm seen and heard.
Seen and heard.
Excellent, excellent. All right, well, hi everybody. Thanks for joining us today and particularly for tuning into my talk here. I'm excited to share with you all some of the results of some work that we've been doing for the past few years at the higher elevations, not just in the Smokies, but throughout Southern Appalachia, looking at leaf litter arthropod diversity in some of these spruce fir forests. So as we've heard, this spruce fir belt is quite unique in the Southern Appalachians. It's really a relic of, let me pull this map up here, a relic of some much wider Pleistocene forests that have receded to these high peaks. And now are these little islands of endemics. And a lot of the other arthropod associates of these communities have followed along and are now isolated on these sky islands, which, you know, extend from the Smokies on up to Mount Rogers in southwestern Virginia. So what we wanted to do was try to get a handle on how much diversity there is in the leaf litter in these environments. And arthropods are an overwhelmingly diverse group, as some of you know, and taxonomic expertise is in pretty short supply. So we wanted to employ a more generic technique using next generation sequencing methods to try and sort all this diversity out and get a sense for how much real diversity we're talking about and then how much of it's restricted to these spruce forests. So what's the levels of endemicity overall? As we've heard already from Tori and Eric, there's a lot of threats to these forests, particularly with climate change. These cool, moist environments are potentially gonna be waning as temperatures warm and precipitation patterns shift. But there are invasive species to be concerned with, certainly the balsam woolly adelgid that we've talked about. But also as things warm, more invasive ants are slowly climbing these mountains. And there's a number of things that might threaten these litter communities. So we wanted to take a shot at trying to figure out how much diversity there was and how much should be protected here along with the forests themselves. So we've seen a few pictures like this already. These are really wonderful environments, particularly when it's 98 degrees in Clemson, can go up into the mountains and enjoy some cool weather. You see my collaborator on this project, Paul Merrick, there sifting some leaf litter and looking for millipedes, which are his favorite group. So, you know, these are just really spectacular environments. There's a fair bit known about other organisms and lots of endemics described, such as salamanders, which we were hearing about earlier. There's also some interesting disjuncts of things that occur further to the north, like New Hampshire and up in, even into Canada. You know, things like this northern flying squirrel and the red-backed vole have populations in these spruce fir forests, but don't occur over much of the intervening area. So, you know, we kind of expect there to be representatives of both of these sorts of things, you know, real endemics that occur nowhere else, but also some of these northern disjuncts that have just been sort of left behind as the community mostly moved northward after the Pleistocene. One of the poster children for endemic arthropods in the region is this endangered spruce fir moss spider, Microhexia montevega. And it occurs on most of these spruce fir peaks from the Smokies up into Virginia. But what's interesting about it, as this cladogram on the left shows, is that it's really a complex of very divergent populations. So pretty much every peak or every range supports a very distinctive genetic isolate of this. And, you know, one of our questions is also, you know, to what extent is that kind of the rule in these populations? Are we looking at a lot of, you know, potentially cryptic speciation with distinct genetic lineages on different peaks? So that's another thing that the molecular approach is going to let us get a sense of. So we'll talk more about that. Our methods, we go up there with these sifters like I'm using there. My son a few years ago is pointing out some particularly rich leaf litter back under this rhododendron. This was not in the spruce fir forest, by the way. So we sift this stuff, we bring it back into the lab. We put it in these funnels, which are the white buckets there, basically warm the litter, and then this wonderful soup of arthropods drops out of it. And I think this sample actually was from Big Cataluchi in the Smokies. So you can see almost everything in there is an arthropod. There's lots of beetles, lots of mites. We've got centipedes, millipedes. There's even a trichopteran in there, which is, I guess the litter was particularly wet to get a caddisfly. But so we've processed lots of these kinds of samples and sorted them. A little bit more specifically, we bring all these samples back and we're sorting them all to morphospecies. So from every site, we try to figure out how many distinct things can we see visually. And then a representative of each of those is extracted. We're amplifying a short CO1 mini barcode, 420 base pairs, which we are starting with Illumina sequencing, which if you're familiar with it, generally limits you to pretty short fragments. We've moved on from that, but this is still a pretty convenient piece that we can amplify for almost all arthropods. So we tag these with specific indices so we can dump them all together and sequence them at once. And now we're sequencing on a nanopore MinION, which you can see my postdoc Ernesto loading there on the right. And the other thing that I know distinguishes this from some metabarcoding projects you might've read about is that we're really concerned with keeping all of the specimens. So we extract these things individually and then save all of the remnants. So we have a specimen that we can link back to each and every indexed sequence. All right. So at this point in the project, we've sampled over 320 different sites, 320 different litter samples. That's given us about 12,000 different arthropod morphospecies. We've extracted over 9,000 individuals. If you want to see an overview of this diversity, every one of those individuals is posted, has a photograph posted to our Flickr site. Really would love to have more traffic marveling at these creatures. And we were able to save over 7,000 of the vouchers. Some of the really small things just got sucked up somewhere along the way and disappeared. But mostly we have a good collection of specimens to go along with all this. So we have about 7,700 barcode sequences, and you can see how, you know, your favorite group ranks here. I'm a coleopterist, a beetle specialist. So we might have focused those on a little bit more, but they are the most diverse insect order anyway. So that's justified. But lots of springtails, lots of mites, lots of fly larvae primarily, spiders, wasps. So tons of diversity there. But we'll see how that starts to look. So one thing with barcoding approaches that people often try is we take all these sequences, we run them through GenBank or some other online database, and we can get nice identifications from all the matches that we're going to get. Fact of the matter is that virtually none of the stuff that we're collecting has ever been barcoded before. So we were able to identify very little. And we wanted to highlight this in a paper that Ernesto has just finished up. So barcoding success. These are kind of the extremes. The best case was with the spiders, which you see on the bottom, where the blue bars show you how many were correctly identified. Almost half, which was really, you know, way better than in most other groups. About half were not identified. A small proportion, the gray bars near the top, were misidentified with high confidence. So those were probably mistaken IDs in the barcode sequence that was originally done. And then some were, in fact, right as far as we could tell. but with such a low probability that you would never have said, yes, that's what that is based on a good match. More groups of arthropods look like the mites, the Acaria there on the top, where, you know, as few as 0% were identified correctly. Most were unidentified, and we often had more misidentifications than correct identifications. So, you know, we've got a long way to go to try and use this approach to identify these things. And that's one of the things that we're trying to do, is build up this reference database so that, you know, you can go out and sample anywhere and get a pretty decent assessment of what something is, at least to the genus level or something like that. This slide is probably the best overarching summary of our results. So this is also from a paper that we're just wrapping up. The bottom line is that these high elevation arthropod faunas are extremely distinctive and extremely rich. So generally a single site would have, you know, more than 200 species. And we've struggled a bit to do all this with the mites just because there's so many of them, but including the mites, well over 200 species per site. And a third of those or more, even half in some places, are endemic to that site alone. And when I talk about a site, I'm talking like Clingman's Dome or Mount LeConte or Big Cataloochee. These things are small, most of them are flightless, and they are very, very differentiated from place to place. And then at the range level, if we were to look at, say, the Smokies as a whole, you can see these numbers in parentheses down here. So that's 313 total arthropods, and that's, the mites are not included in those numbers. That was some analyses we did without them. And then 226 of those Smokies arthropods are only within the Smokies, so not shared with any neighboring range like the plot balsam. So these are extremely unique faunas and lots of species that occur nowhere else. If you break this down a little bit more by taxonomic group, some groups on the low end were maybe 40% endemic to a site. And that was things like spiders, which, you know, they balloon even though they don't fly. So they're more widely distributed than we might have expected. And then many groups like diplurans and proturans, very small flightless arthropods, if you know them. Entirely unique to each site, very, very distinct genetically. Oop, lost something there. Okay, there we go. This little NMDS plot on the bottom right now is another kind of a statistical way to show how distinctive these faunas are. And the one point I wanted to make here was that even though I've drawn these ellipses around the Smokies peaks, the Smokies as a whole doesn't really kind of hold together as a unique and identifiable unit in terms of diversity. Big Cataloochee and more the kind of eastern part of the park is actually closer to some of the peaks in the plot balsams than to some of those further south in the park. So distance is, you know, as important as, you know, what you might look at on a map is really distinctive topographic units. We've got a lot more to do to tease all this apart. But I wanted to spend the rest of my time, which is going quickly, looking at some specific cases here. So my postdoc Ernesto is really interested in terrestrial isopods. And this is a group where there were only two described species in the region before. And, you know, we've easily got a couple dozen genetic species that have very little morphological difference. And he's gone beyond just the CO1 data in these and shown that, you know, these divergences hold up in other genes as well. So the stars here and others are going to be distinct ones that do occur in the Smokies. Another group that we've looked at are springtails. So at the morphospecies level, we sorted these into about 30 species, but in genetic terms, there's, you know, at a minimum 40 some and probably as many as 80. Many of these look very much alike, but when we start looking closely at how morphotypes correspond to some of the clades in the tree, we do see that things that have been considered variable, like this Neosminthurus, actually have distinctive color patterns that have, you know, genetic markers to go along with them. So there's going to be a number of cases like that in this group for sure, and probably in others. One of my graduate students, Pat Wooden, is working on trechis. This is a group that's gotten a fair bit of attention before. In fact, most of the species out of 50 occurring in the Southern Appalachians are described. But we're interested in understanding the relationships and their biogeographic history, because they've certainly moved around some. But really strange things like 7 different species occurring together on Clingman's Dome. So this is clearly multiple radiations over time. And in the Smokies as a whole, we've got lots of species in this group. This is a group that I just finished working up toward the end of last year. It's a rove beetle now, used to be in its family Scidminidae. And this was a subgenus of Euconus that had never been detected in the New World. It was thought to be only in Europe and Asia. But in fact, we've got 13 species in this group. And a number of those occur in the Smokies as well. Most of them, again, high elevation endemics. I've got another student working on a rove beetle genus called Lithrobium. Several new species here. One species that we thought was pretty well characterized, this Lithrobium carolinae, is in fact 2. Sorry, I didn't mean to advance there. This red one in the middle, we've got some blind species, and looks like a couple of different ones of those in the Smokies. We've got larvae of most of these, so that's what we're looking at there. And that's another kind of interesting aspect of this data set, is that very few of these insects have been associated with their immature stages, and we've been able to do that with the DNA. This is another rove beetle that, in fact, I was working on this morning while listening to the other talks. It's a new species, undescribed before, and is very widespread. But again, we've got deep genetic divergences among different areas and probably multiple species there. I could go on, but I think I'm going to run out of time. So I want to jump ahead and talk about some future things that we want to do with this data set. We've got lots more life stage associations. So we've got, this is a fly where we've actually got larvae, pupae, and adults all sequenced and associated for the first time. So we wanna do a lot more of these kind of drawing life histories together. And then we're looking for collaborators to work on some of the things like mites, which we've struggled with. There's a lot of really interesting patterns in the springtails, which will take some time to work through. Not all of the spiders are widespread and sort of uniform. There are a lot of endemics here and probably some new ones. A couple of things that, if you're familiar with barcoding approaches, are worth the thinking about. First of all, our sampling really has focused mostly on these high elevation areas. So even though we're seeing differences between, the Smokies and the plot balsams, for example, we don't really have good enough samples in the lowlands between them to say, exactly where the genetic breaks are occurring. If these things are really strictly high elevation, or if there are some other environmental barriers to them getting around. So we need to work on that. And then, although with a few of the cases that I've talked about, we have generated some other genes to help shore up some of the patterns that we see in CO1. We really need to do that for a number of other things, because it is, certainly possible that CO1 is giving us kind of an exaggerated picture of diversity. But with a number of groups so far, the things that look very distinct in CO1 are also distinct when we look at other genes as well. So with that, I want to thank a lot of the folks in my lab who have helped out with this, my collaborator, Paul Merrick up at Virginia Tech, and then many of the folks who are here in this meeting with Discover Life in America and Great Smoky Mountains National Park, who have helped us out with everything from permits to coming out in the field with us. Thank you, Will. So anyway, I appreciate your attention. And if I've got time, I'd be happy to take a question or two.
And if you want to look at that Flickr, I put the link to the Caterino Labs Flickr in the chat.
And thank you.
Any other questions?
See a hand. Alexander?
Hi. First, I wanted to say I appreciate that you didn't overinterpret your metabarcoding data. I see that a lot where people read a little too much into just COI. But second, I was wondering if you could do analyses based on, or to do diversity-based analyses with the data that you have, because you have COI metabarcoding data, and you also have specimens, correct? So you could link, instead of just getting relative abundance from your metabarcoding, you could probably link number of specimens to identities and then do some diversity analyses. Am I wrong about that?
Well, you're not wrong, but our abundance data is not really absolute. With a sample, we could have 10,000 arthropods in a single sample, and we would pull things out sort of, you know, relative to their abundances, but generally we're focusing on the rarer things and making sure we get all of those, and a lot of the more common things get ignored. So it wouldn't be strict, you know, abundance data, but it'd be correlated. But yeah, we've certainly thought about that.
Okay, thank you.
All right. If anyone has any additional questions, please put them in the Q&A folder at the bottom of your screen. We'll move on to another level of biodiversity that's sometimes hard to get one's mind around. Ellen Swank of Western Carolina University. Microbial communities as indicators of ecosystem function and sustainability.
Hey, everybody. Let's see, can I share my screen? Let's see.
It should be on the bottom, share screen, and then pick your PowerPoint. You got it. Okay.
Screen sharing. Okay.
Looks good.
We're good.
All right. Let me move some of these other windows here. All right. Hey, everyone. My name's Elin Swank. I work with Dr.